Okay, so I have chosen the letter Y for my Abécédaire contribution. Am I imagining it that the letter Y in French is known as Y? I feel like that's what I learned as a student of the French language many years ago. And I partly chose this just because, thinking prudentially, I didn't want those hard to find letters to get put years down the road. I didn't want to do one of the obvious letters. I thought we could knock off one of the more obscure letters. And my Y stands for yoga. I started doing yoga a long time ago, and I think because we're people of the book and academics and so forth, it's really important to do things, first of all, that mostly involve the body or the brain in tandem with the body, rather than just thinking of the mind as a kind of disembodied thing interacting with words and books. So I've always found yoga valuable for that reason, and I have also found it valuable because I think it's important for those of us who are scholars and teachers to realize that the fact that we're professors is partly due to the fact that we've always been very gifted students in most of the academic classrooms that we've been in. It's very valuable for us as adults and as capable professors to be students of things in other parts of our lives where we are not the most gifted student in the room. So I've been studying yoga for a long time, and actually I think my brain is pretty good at yoga, but my body is extremely inflexible. I lack souplesse, as you might say in French. And one of my great pleasures this year in Paris has been to be in an environment that really beautifully complements the space that I'm in at the Institute. The Institute is an Anglophone space for the most part, and it's a very intellectual space. And right down the street on the Rue Campagne Première is an amazing studio called Yoga Garden Rive Gauche, where I take yoga classes and I take them in French. So in many ways, the relationship with the yoga is continuous with my past experience of yoga, but there's some kind of an extra frisson or layer, it's an estrangement that somehow can actually produce even greater immersion or sense of identification. So as to say, I've fallen in love with the postures again because I'm so captivated by the phrases that describe them in French. One that I really was taken with a week or two ago, si le dos est arrondi. So all that's really just saying is, if the back is rounded, and it's a warning that your yoga teacher will give you in any language, which is to say, you're in certain kind of postures and you're beginning to lean forward, but the goal is to keep a flat back, to keep your clavicule open, and you only are gonna go as far forward as you can still go while keeping your back flat. So si le dos est arrondi, if you've begun to fold over, you need to pull back a little bit and regain that open flat back position that was the real idea of the posture. So clearly for me, having words that I can hear and kind of fall in love with is giving me an even more profound or pervasive awareness of the posture. The last example, another piece of a verbal phrase or a series of words that I was absolutely captivated by. Many yoga classes will end with a relaxation exercise that's something like what might be called in a meditation tradition, a body scan, which is to say that the teacher leading the class will talk the students through, you're probably lying on your back in Shavasana, corpse pose. We've already got that third language in here, right? The Sanskrit words that yoga teachers often use. A kind of guided meditation that will end class, that will move perhaps from head to toe, perhaps from toe to head, through the parts of the body, and hearing the names of each of those parts uttered by a thoughtful teacher in French, it's hard for me to even put into words why I find that so amazing. And the particular bit of this class that I'm thinking about now had to do with when the teacher got to talking about the hands, so you've relaxed your wrists and so forth. And then this teacher, Delphine, it's a class called Yoga Thérapie pour Dos, a very simple, pure yoga that's to loosen up your back. Then she started naming the individual digits on the hand. She said, la pouce, l'index, le majeur, l'annulaire, l'auriculaire. And so as I heard those words, I was somehow able to both focus on actually relaxing the individual fingers of my hand and on the beauty of the history of this vocabulary that's for the parts of the hand. I don't think that the words in English are nearly so vivid. Yes, you can say pinky finger, something like that, but ring finger, and so forth. But in French, the words are really, they're more compressed and they're more resonant of history. So annulaire brings, it's the name for the ring finger, the fourth finger, but it really brings the Latinate history of the language to mind. And auriculaire also, I looked it up. It may be a false etymology, but apparently the little finger is called the auriculaire in French in many cognate Romance languages, because it's the finger that's small enough to stick in your ear and screw it around to clean out the earwax. So that is why for yoga. Yoga is neither a French nor an English word, really, but I wanted to give my little story about doing yoga in French as an illustration of the letter éclat.